year ago, I gave a lesson here one time on regard to epitaphs that you might have in the Bible. Epitaphs, I talked about something I had gotten interested in many, many years ago. Me and two of my brothers had traveled out west to California, but on the way out, we stopped at several different places, stopped at one place, Tombstone, Arizona, and went out to Boot Hill and found one of the epitaphs on the gravesite out there of a gentleman by the name of Lester Moore. His epitaph read, "Here lies the body of Lester Moore, four slugs from a 44. No less, no more." It's kind of similar to one that my dad had told me about that he had seen. I don't know if it was a real one or not, but it was about a gentleman by the name of Owen Moore. And his tombstone epitaph read, "Owen Moore, gone away. Owen Moore than he could pay." And I thought, well, that sounds like a lot of people that I know. But anyhow, what I tried to do from that time was just to look at the Bible. An epitaph is something that's meant to draw up a person's life and explain it in just a few short words. And so I looked in and talked at that time about different characters in the Bible, at least four different characters in the Bible, and what their epitaph might be. First of all, we talked about Abraham. The Bible says of Abraham, not once, not twice, but three different times, and describes him as a friend of God. And I thought, wouldn't that be a great epitaph for him, or for any person? If it could honestly be said to sum up their life, he's a friend of God. Or think about David, the greatest king that Israel had ever had at the time. And David was a great king, but as I thought about how would you explain his life, what would you do to sum up his David, or his life at one time? And I thought about David and the statement that's made of him, that David was a friend of God, but more than that, that David was one who was devoted to God. And I think it would be great if you could say about somebody like David, here's a man after God's own heart. And again, that's said of David at least two different times in the Bible. He's a man after God's own heart. He's someone not perfect, but he's striving to be like God, to have a heart like God has. And what a great epitaph that would be. And then you think about two different men. Noah would be one and Enoch the other, of whom it could honestly be said he walked with God. And that would be a great way to describe anyone's life if you could honestly say of the individual, they walked with God. And then what about Jesus? You know, there's so many good things that the Bible says about Christ, and there's everything about him is good. But how would you describe his life? And I thought about in the book of Acts chapter 10, verse 38, the statement is made of Jesus there that he went about doing good. How would you describe his life? That's a great way to describe the life of our Lord. He went about doing good. But tonight, I wanted to look at another individual from the Bible and how we might describe him. This is a man by the name of Gaius. He is an individual to whom John wrote his third epistle. It's a little short book, just 14 verses long, but he says something remarkable there about Gaius. We believe that this Gaius that John talks about is the same one who had accompanied Paul on Paul's last journey from Corinth down to Jerusalem. In the book of Acts, we're told about him in Acts 20 and verse 4. It says, "And Sopater of Berea accompanied him to Asia, also Aristarchus and Secundus of the Thessalonians, and Gaius of Derbe, and Timothy and Tychicus and Trophimus of Asia." So here's this man, Gaius. There are several people mentioned in the Bible that have that name. But this man, we believe, is the same one to whom John wrote. And listen to what John said about this man in the second verse there of that little epistle of John. John says to Gaius, "Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health just as your soul prospered." Here's a man who, if I was thinking about what would you use to describe his life, what would be his epitaph, it would be simple, this statement. He's the man whose soul prospered. And I thought about that. How would you want, if the Apostle Paul were alive today, and Paul was going to pray for you specifically, what would you want Paul to pray about for you? Would you want Paul to utter a prayer like, "May you prosper in all things as Bill Gates prospers"? Oh man, yes. Here's a man that's worth maybe $60 billion. Yes, yes, yes. Pray that I'll prosper like that. Or what if he prayed for you that you may be in health as Methuselah was? Oh, yeah. 969 years he lived. Boy, You know, it'd be great if I was in health that I could live that long. Yes, pray for me like that. But what if Paul prayed for you the same prayer that he prayed for Gaius? And that is that he prayed for him that you might prosper in all things and be in health even as your soul prospers. If he prayed that prayer for you, would that prayer be a blessing or a curse? Of course, that all is going to be dependent upon how does your soul prosper. If one is not a child of God, there's no prospering of his soul. Being without Christ, there's no hope, and he's separated from God's kingdom. If you prosper, like Paul talks about here, to prosper as your soul prospers, I would think that a person would understand that if I'm not a Christian, I'm not prospering. I'm not prospering spiritually. Because if I'm not following Christ, I still have all of my sins that I've ever committed with me, and those sins keep me separated from God, and those sins will condemn me eternally to hell. And so I want to make sure that all of my sins have been removed, and I do that through my obedience to Christ. My faith that will lead me to repent, to confess Him before men, and be baptized with Christ to have all of my sins forgiven. And once I do that, those sins are removed, then my soul is prospering. It's in a right relationship with God. But I've got to continually be living for God the way I should, day by day. I've got to be faithful to Him. Because if I'm not faithful, then those sins are taking over my life again, and my soul is not prospering. But when I become God's child and I live for God as I should, when the Bible talks about it in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 7, if I'm walking in the light, that is according to God's Word, then I have fellowship one with another, and the blood of His Son Jesus Christ cleanses me from all sins. That's present tense. It means it keeps on cleansing me of all sins. Just like when you get in a car and it's raining, as it's done here so much lately, and you turn your windshield wiper on, and it begins. You cut it on just one time, but it keeps on washing the water off your windshield. When an individual is obedient to Christ and becomes a child and lives faithfully and walking in the light as He is in the light, then the blood of Christ is continually cleansing us from all our sins. If you're a faithful child of God, your soul is prospering as well as it could ever do. And then, if Paul prayed for you, may you prosper in all things and in health as your soul prospers. That would be a prayer that would bring great blessings to you. But tonight, if you're not living for God as you should, you're not His child, or as His child, you're not living faithful to Him, your soul's not prospering. And so a prayer like that would be a curse. But what an example Gaius sets for us, that we can live our lives in such a way that our soul prospers. And the prayer of God's people is, may you also prosper in all that you do in life. May you prosper in health as your soul prospers. That is, to the very best possible to you. Tonight, if you're not His child or His child that's not living for you, make things right with Him tonight by your obedience to Him, that you might truly be prospering in your soul's health, that you might prosper in all things and in physical health. If you need to respond to Him, as we stand and sing this song, we're doing that to encourage you to make your life right with Him, and do that now while we stand and sing.